Good afternoon to everyone. We are coming to the last section, called it special section. Special section is not because we have the last section of the day, but of course, this section is for young leaders. You understand that since 2015, we initiated the South China Sea Young Leader Program. And the young leaders are working very actively and very hard up to this moment. They intended to make their program be awarded the Nobel Prize. They tried, and we also helped them to try. Today, the Young Leader Program responsible for two main target or objective. Firstly, getting fresh view from young scholars how to manage disputes and in South China Sea, and engaging, building the research interest of the new young generation of scholars on the maritime disputes and dispute management in South China Sea. This is our challenge. For the section today, they will start with a presentation of what they have researched, what they have discussed, so that we, this is the older generation, can contribute in the manner. Who will take the floor first?
Well, ladies and gentlemen, before I start, a few comments. First of all, on behalf of all the young leaders, let me thank the Diplomatic Academy of Vietnam for generously extending an invitation to this conference to us. Secondly, let me thank Ha Chuen for bringing this group together and coordinating our discussions over the last 2 days. Then I would also like to just mention that we discussed the issues we are raising here over the last 2 days. So if the PowerPoint slides are not fancy, you know, we don't have nice pictures, this is because we discussed what we are presenting here over lunch and over dinner. So we did not have the luxury to prepare this over the last few months. And yes, last but not least, I want to thank you for the honor to call us young leaders. I'm not sure whether we deserve this label, but we will do our best. So I'm going to talk the next 50 minutes about the topic of turning the South China Sea into a sea of peace and development. So if we look about the last 25 years of the South China Sea kind of negotiations, then we will find all these points coming up regularly at conferences. Right? We have cooperation on non-traditional security issues and then all these things. Professor Tonnesen was asking, why is it that since the 2002 declaration on a code of conduct until today, there was kind of tensions were increasing rather than decreasing after a first kind of period of six rather peaceful years. So, and part of the explanation may be that kind of the ambitious projects on cooperation on non-traditional security issues were much less successful than we thought they could be. So the idea of transforming the South China Sea into a sea of peace and cooperation somehow failed if we look into the details. Where is progress on concrete cooperation projects on which issues. So, and if I may recall our the last discussion and the last panel, we could say that despite kind of multi-layered arrangements, there is not enough real progress for decreasing or for preventing recurrent tensions. So in some sense, in the South China Sea, the number of fora arrangements and mechanism correlates positively with the intensity of the disputes. And so we could ask, why is that so? And the answer probably is that the idea of non-traditional security cooperation is to cooperate despite boundary and territorial disputes. But today we probably have to kind of conclude that this is rather too ambitious. It is very difficult to circumvent the dynamics that arise from these disputes and to bring forward cooperation on concrete issues in the South China Sea. So if we take these kind of mechanisms, track two diplomacy, to have long-standing discussions on joint fishery arrangements, joint development arrangements. Robert Beckman was hinting to the point that joint development is now off the table because there are no overlapping zones. So the problem of joint development over the last 25 years was somehow states couldn't agree on an area for joint development. If we analyze the negotiations on the code of conduct, we will find a code of conduct is difficult because states cannot agree on where not to apply the code of conduct. And for the regional diplomacy, I already mentioned the problem here. And the problem with third-party dispute settlement, well, if some states don't accept it, don't want it for legitimate reasons, reserving their rights, then I don't see how kind of it is also kind of, we discussed that, I can say, I would conclude over the last 2 days, which influence does that have on the overall kind of dynamics of the South China Sea disputes? So to conclude, the mechanisms that were discussed over the last 25 years that were designed to either explicitly or implicitly circumvent the dynamics of territorial and boundary disputes, and kind of try to disconnect limited cooperation and disputes. That was somehow not possible. So we can draw two lessons from that. First, the question, how can these state-to-state mechanisms be applied differently? So how could one make these mechanisms more reciprocal? Which combination of mechanisms is possible? May there be a combination of joint development, joint fishery zones? Good. So the kind of overall question is how to redesign some of these mechanisms. So the second lessons we could draw from that is the question whether non-state actor cooperation could be a way to circumvent some of the dynamics that arise from these disputes. So if the overall question is how to circumvent these disputes to have concrete cooperation on concrete issues and it doesn't work on the state-to-state level, well, we could try a non-state level. So let me see. Okay, yes. So here are a number of proposals we discussed over the last 2 days, and I would like to start with the Regional Institute for South China Sea Studies. The idea of that is we don't have enough scientific data on the South China Sea when it comes to marine biology, when it comes to fisheries, when it comes to the ecosystems, to resilience of the ecosystem. So we are unable to integrate the existing data. So if you look into kind of fishery statistics, we had the discussion, there is no fishery statistics for the South China Sea. We have national fishery statistics, but then these apply for much wider areas. So China, the East China Sea, Yellow Sea, South China Sea, Pacific, and so on. So Maybe I could also make another proposal. If someone wants to fund a PhD on fishery statistics in the South China Sea, I think that would be an excellent idea. A second advantage of such a regional institute could be to build a community of scientists from the littoral states to engage in collecting data, to engage in kind of developing policies out of this joint scientific effort. The next proposal, non-state actor cooperation on fisheries or on maritime marine conservation, sorry. So I just, you know, not to make too many abstract arguments here, I simply present two kind of examples. We could have recommendation, we could have guidelines, we could think about kind of these guidelines being implemented in national jurisdictions. From China Marine Biological Association and the Vietnam Marine Biological Association that kind of agree on the kind of a certain kind of, cap on the release of a certain pollutant into some area of the South China Sea. There is no need to define explicitly with a nice line which area is kind of the target area. One could say, well, the northwestern area of the South China Sea. So that is kind of the weakest cooperation one could imagine, right? Don't define precisely the area, have some idea, well, the northwestern area between China and Vietnam, it's coming from the associations, and then as we leave kind of the enforcement to domestic jurisdictions. I mean, I know the difficulties in that, right? Whether it will work, when which kind of monitoring mechanisms will be used. But this is kind of the weakest level of cooperation one could imagine that is not susceptible to, or much less susceptible to boundary disputes. And then there is this other example with kind of when it comes to agreeing on catch limits for fishery. Of course, this is based on, should be based on an idea of how much catch would be sustainable for the South China Sea, and we don't know that. So here we have clearly a lack of data. This is just some ideas how non-state actor could cooperate, and you could imagine all kinds of variations of that, right? It does not need to be bilateral, it could be multilateral. You could have more than only recommendations. You could think about an auto-monitoring of the associations and so on. Yes, so I want to give the floor to my colleague, Kirin, who is presenting the other proposals.
Thank you, Christian. A core theme of our discussions has been the absence of trust in the region, which, beyond our group, has also been touched upon quite heavily in the presentations over the last 2 days. It almost goes without saying at this point that the escalating tensions over the last decade have all but erased trust and confidence among the claimants. But the manner in which recent political developments in the region have relieved these tensions, even if, as has been suggested, it's only a temporary phenomenon, this offers hope that there is room for other levels of interaction between states. To build trust, it is vital to convince the parties that their interests lie in the working together. And the best point of entry for this is the identification of common interests and public goods. Three of these stood out in particular in our analysis: capacity building, environmental concerns, and the establishment of a common line of communication for vessels at sea. Regarding the environment, joint projects on the environmental front allow for the social and economic integration of claimant states. Indeed, The main focus of these projects is to make clear to the publics of South China Sea states the risk posed by environmental degradation. We take a three-pronged approach. Sorry, is that... Yeah, can we go back there? Sorry? Go back? Yes. Ah, thank you. Thank you. We therefore take a three-pronged approach. First, ecotourism. There are tour packages currently being offered in China which bring tourists parts of the South China Sea. What we propose is a joint ecotourism enterprise managed and operated by various businesses from claimant states, which will further this project, bringing tourists to the South China Sea and giving them first-hand experience of the need for environmental protection in the region, with further benefits available for states in the form of the financial dividends. There are potential issues to be worked out before this can take place. Naturally, there exist at the government level the issues of legal jurisdiction over the areas being visited, not least the issues of who has legal jurisdiction in such areas, what responsibility is held for crimes, extraterritoriality and such issues, and whether immigration regulations need to apply to such areas. Secondly, environmental impact research. As has been established, there is a very real need for scientific investigation into the South China Sea. And this must take place to determine the state of fisheries and work towards their sustainable management. This research should be a joint project to ensure a balanced approach is taken, which protects the integrity of the findings and makes sure they can be accepted by all states involved. Finally, to ensure that a large number of people understand the environmental importance of the South China Sea, measures must be taken to ensure that the findings of that joint environmental research reach as many people as possible. They should be accessible to the public and easily understandable in layman's terms. Such measures could include, for instance, the joint production of documentaries and publications for the consumption of audiences in the various littoral states. In terms of capacity building, we look to the European Union as an existing example of resolution of multilateral maritime disputes, with this experience providing a valuable and relatable framework for the situation in the South China Sea. Adding to its role as an extra-regional stakeholder and a neutral party in the various disputes, we find that there is opportunity for the European Union to act as an honest broker in the region. Related to European Union maritime dispute resolution is the status of the European Union as the only UNCLOS signatory which is an international organisation, a status which leads us to propose that ASEAN examine accession to UNCLOS or, at the very least, further its development of IUU regulations to help coordinate fisheries management and policing across that multilateral framework. Another major area we identified for cooperation was the potential for diplomacy at the level of the individual, that is, person-to-person diplomacy. As new generations of political, military, and business leaders are raised and educated in states around the South China Sea, we propose an exchange program which will enable annual visits to littoral states with a particular focus on coastal regions to help highlight the real impacts of South China Sea policy on the communities around the region and the ecosystems upon which their livelihoods depend, in the interest of that broader goal of broadening awareness of the fragility of that shared environment. Following on this point, we propose the establishment of a network of young leaders. Each country shall have a national network of young leaders and an annual meeting in a central location to discuss issues in the South China Sea relevant to their country and the region, with a broader regional meeting between those discrete national groups, which will allow them all to interact every 2 years. Next, we have the proposal of establishing a code of conduct for maritime enforcement vessels of the different claimant states, something that has already been touched upon quite extensively today, especially. This is necessary because while there are already clear guidelines for military vessels in the form of queues, the bulk of incidents in the South China Sea, as many as 71% between 2010 and 2016, now involve Coast Guard or other maritime law enforcement vessels. This is complicated by the fact that the functions of these agencies can vary greatly, with whatever little multilateral cooperation there is often hampered by those conflicting and differing remits. In this case, the institutions and platforms through which a code of conduct or encounter might be achieved already exist. The key issue is simply one of political will to adapt the existing naval-centric principles of queues to a non-military or paramilitary framework as part of a broader program of increasing bilateral cooperation and understanding amongst claimant states. Now, given the existing sensitivities in the region, we agreed that it was unrealistic to expect this to be all accomplished at once. So small, incremental steps must be taken to expect this to be, and existing platforms like the ASEAN Maritime Forum could serve as the setting for multilateral discussions. In turn, these fora and discussions could lead to further confidence-building exercises, familiarization visits, tabletop exercises, and so forth. As a final idea, our group developed something from the old adage that good fences make good neighbours. That is, the possibility for a joint submission on the part of the Philippines, Malaysia and Vietnam to the Commission on the Limits of the Continental Shelf, which would allow these three to coordinate their claims and clearly delineate a mutually agreed upon maritime border. This would build on the precedent established of the joint Malaysia-Philippines proposal. In seeking an award from the CLCS, the idea is that the Commission would be able to determine that there is no continental shelf generated by any of those geographical features in the Spratlys, which would in turn restrict the claims of littoral states to those extending from their respective mainlands. With regard to the objections China could theoretically raise to such a joint submission, it's important to note that we did not technically find any legal grounds to do so. In conjunction with the ruling of the PCA, this measure could therefore help build those good maritime fences and open the path to becoming better neighbours by raising the prospect of joint exploration and extraction of natural resources. In this case, we refer to the example of France, Ireland, Spain, and the UK, where a quadripartite submission was made on the status of their continental shelves in 2006, establishing a useful precedent for such measures. It is here that we conclude our presentation, and time to spare. Thank you for listening to our proposals, and we await your questions or criticisms, as the case may well be. Thank you.
Thank you. Other young leaders, you have any comment or amendment to the presentation? Whose idea? Good, thank you. It's time for us to raise a question for the young leaders. I think the presentation is an excellent, comprehensive one. One of the things they stress on is the trust building. They also touched on a series of things that we have discussed in the last 2 days. Fishery, maritime conservation, and trust building, the project joint development semester. So please take your freedom to raise any question or comment to the young leaders. The floor is yours now. Yes, please.
It's not a question, it's a comment. It would be very nice to hear who you are sitting up there on the table. Thank you.
All right, then we go for a self-introduction. So my name is Christian Schultheis. I'm a PhD candidate at the University of Cambridge, and I study political conditions for applying dispute settlement mechanisms in maritime disputes.
I'm Kieran Ireland, studying at the Victoria University of Wellington in New Zealand. I'm currently doing my master's research on the South China Sea disputes implications for New Zealand and New Zealand's policy approaches to the region.
My name is Phạm Ngọc Minh Trang, and I'm a researcher from the Vietnam National University. I also was a former researcher in the Tribunal for Law of the Sea in Hamburg, Germany.
My name is Trang Lee, and I'm a part-time researcher and a full-time learner at the Diplomatic Academy of Vietnam.
Okay, maybe I can use this one. Yeah. So my name is Zhu Ting Shu, and I'm from China. And I see that there's a very limited number of Chinese here today. Yeah, so I feel very stressed. Yeah, and I received my master's degree in Xiamen University as an interpreter, and now I'm a PhD candidate in Mahidong University, Thailand, and I work in multicultural studies. So I received my education mostly from ethnographic research. Yeah.
Hi, I'm Eng Chiu Yi from Ezra Jumlin School of International Studies. I belong to the military studies program, so I study the military.
Good afternoon, I'm Alethea Valenciano. I'm a researcher at the Institute for Strategic and Development Studies in the Philippines.
Good evening, my name is Thomas Daniel. I am an analyst at ISIS Malaysia. I'm Alina Siminian. Thank you.
Thank you. You know the young leaders on the table. Now, could you start the question? Yes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Actually, I would like to thank the DPA, the EC Foundation, and the Lawyers Association of Vietnam for this important forum for our young leaders and younger generations, promising young leaders in the future to help maintain peace and stability. So we are counting on you. So my question to you, all of you here, is do you think it's a good proposal to have a summer camp in the South China Sea? Let me give you two or three precedents. U.S. State Department had this kind of program on biodiversity to invite college students to learn to study marine biodiversity in the South China Sea. And Taiwan and mainland China also have this kind of cross-strait summer camp program. Now, for the region, this region, do you consider, is it possible, is it a good idea to have this kind of educational program for scholars, not only students from ASEAN member states, Vietnam, Thailand, Malaysia, Philippines, and so on, but also countries from Europe, from the United States, from Japan, Korea, to get together and to discuss this kind of issue? So that's my question to our young leaders. Thank you.
Here.
Thank you. I'd like to follow up with the previous comment and congratulate all of the young leaders up there. So as part of the discussion and as part of your presentation, you mentioned the idea of some form of DOC/COC framework. I'd like to push you a bit further and talk about practical policy ideas, because right now, let's assume for a while that the DOC is settled, because we've already settled the DOC in 02, but we sort of tried to build up into a legally binding COC, hopefully, right? In the ASEAN summit meeting a few months ago, there was this discussion that by next year we could have a COC, although I think the accurate representation would be actually the principles of the COC. So if it's true that the principles of the COC could be agreed upon next year as the previous step towards the COC, what would you think the principles should look like? Tell us five key principles of a COC that you think can build into an actually legally binding COC that's not only ideal, but also realistically acceptable to all of the parties. Thank you.
I need to get two more questions. Yes, please.
Thanks. I think the young leaders have done a wonderful job making a presentation, and I just thought that some of the suggestions that you made were very interesting. But I want to know from you that as young people that sort of think differently from the older generation, what are two concrete suggestions that you might have, or two concrete critiques of the way that things are being pursued at the moment, both on the security side and the development side, the security and you know, developmental meaning, fisheries, infrastructure, building, whatever else there is. Is there a suggestion that can tell us that we're fundamentally mistaken in the way we are pursuing certain activities? Do you think there is a radically new approach to dealing with the existing problems? Just two suggestions.
I have got a very simple question for the young leaders. I think nowadays the role of media is very important. So how do you see that? Can we make use of the role of media to our advantage and bringing up these issues, I would say, positively instead of negatively? You know, sometimes you see that things being blown up by media. Is it a good way of using the media? Or how best can we use media to the advantage of gaining some grounds in arbitrations or in any of the things that we want to do in the South China Sea?
Thank you. We can take the first the four questions. You?
On behalf of the group, I will answer the first question about a good proposal of a summer camp for students around the region to go together, study, learn about South China Sea dispute, and maybe propose, like us, propose a resolution to the dispute here. And as a young leader who have privilege to visit and participate a number of summer academy around the world from South Korea, from Shanghai, Denmark, and South Africa last year, I can say that this idea is wonderful. But if Taiwan and China want to open that kind of summer camp or summer academy, you have to push the information to us to let us know that there is a summer camp and what it is about and how to apply for it. And the best way to reach young generation is via Facebook and Twitter. And that's my answer.
The question relating to declaration of conduct and code of conduct. Anyone? Okay.
Before we go to the question of the code of conduct, can I add something to the summer camp? Is it okay? So our colleague Min just mentioned Facebook and Twitter, and you do know that we can't use Facebook and Twitter right now on mainland China. So I guess, first of all, we need to have like a mechanism that we can together, all of those climate countries and also maybe ASEAN member countries, we join together and we have the plan first. And we just make the information clear and we have a good channel of distributing the information to make sure that every member country can know that. And we share the same platform. And the distribution of information is equal. So I guess that's the kind of insurance mechanism we need to have first. And about code of conduct, I didn't know much about this because I'm from ethnographic field. Okay, I'll give you the floor.
Right, okay, talk about being thrown under the bus. I will try and address all the questions, and let me start from the last question with Datuk Chin first about the role of the media. My personal view in this is that that when it comes to the South China Sea, given the nature of media among the claimant states in Asia, I would hazard to say that it has been used to highlight a very national perspective on the dispute. When you go to, I haven't seen overt examples of it in Malaysia because we do make an effort to sort of keep the South China Sea dispute off the national discourse. But I have seen articles in coming out from Indonesia, coming out from the Philippines, and of course coming out from China that take a very nationalist view of the dispute. And this is going to, but has inflamed popular sentiment about it, which will eventually make it harder for governments to negotiate a dispute out when you leave yourself with very little room to do so. Social media is another thing we should watch out for. It's very easy to conflate, to inflame stuff there. The recent US elections is an example of that. Let me come to your question about the five things on the COC. Truth be told, Evan, I have never given it any thought because I am so disappointed, I'm so downcast when it comes to the eventual COC. I was willing to bet money that I will probably never see a COC, never see a conclusion of a COC within the next 6 years. And truth be told, and I'm going to be very frank about it, I have always looked at the negotiations of the COC as a time buying and as a delaying tactic that the Chinese use. Some people might not like to hear it, but that's how I look at it. But however, Evan, you have given me something to think about, so perhaps an article on five things I would like to see in the COC might be due soon. Mr. Abhijit, the question on how things are being pursued, critiques and perhaps suggestions. I think judging from discussions here and in fact other conferences, there is not a lack of ideas. We have ideas. We even have, in many cases, the institutions to work on it. What seems lacking to me is actual political will to get things off the road. Now, whether we can work on this on track two, I do not know. But I think this is the biggest challenge that we must answer. And lastly, the summer camp. I think it's a great idea, but you know what else would be great? We need this sort of exchange between our frontline officials and the South China Sea. We need the officials who face each other, not just the Navy and the Coast Guard, but the guys at the provincial level to sort of meet each other and sort of understand, to basically build some common ground. I know for a fact that, in Malaysia, certain agencies have tried to pursue this, but it hasn't, unofficially, it hasn't met any sort of favorable response whatsoever. But that's my take. Thank you.
Good. The follow-up question, yes?
Yes, I'd just like to add as well to, in terms of the question about the role of the media in this, I think a big problem is that it's very easy as academics to exist in quite a rarefied atmosphere. I mean, we're aware of the subtle connections between what happens 1,000 miles away upon our lives here, but the vast majority of people are not. And I think the challenge is that we need to make people aware of the significance of these conflicts and tensions to their everyday lives. What does a fisheries dispute have to do with the price of beer, to coin a phrase? It's a matter of, and that's why we put quite an emphasis on the matter of explaining things to people in the simplest terms possible, not condescending to them, but just engaging with people in a language that they can all understand.
Well, Dr. Singh, you were asking for 2 points. Well, I will give you three. One, criticism. The status quo. The status quo in the South China Sea is not benefiting any country in the South China Sea. I have the impression states addressing to the South China Sea are of the opposite example. The status quo is better than the options for dispute settlement they have. Well, otherwise they would probably settle their disputes, but they don't, so the status quo must in some sense be superior. But I don't believe that the status quo is superior. It's not benefiting China. And it's not benefiting the Philippines, for sure. It's certainly not benefiting Vietnam either. So the status quo is not the best available option. Number two, the various options of a kind of dispute settlement or kind of cooperative approaches that kind of I tried to give a rough overview of why it didn't work in the last 25 years. I would say, well, we need more flexibility in applying them. And by more flexibility, I mean, think outside the box, right? You want a joint development area that doesn't work, well, then do two, or three, or four. It doesn't work with state actors, well, try private actors, a joint venture. A code of conduct is difficult to agree because, you know, it's binding, and then in some areas you may not want to have that. Well, try to combine it with other tools. Right? You have a joint fishery agreement somewhere in the northern area of the South China Sea and the code of conduct somewhere in the western part and the southern part, right? So this is a kind of flexibility I'm asking for. And I haven't seen much of that in the debate. And the third point is, I know the nature of the disputes is that all claims are indisputable. Now, if you start negotiations on kind of on any dispute settlement, the implementation of some dispute settlement tools with the idea, like, we need to make sure that kind of our claims are, after we agreed on a certain tool, as strong as they were before. We didn't give up anything, not one single millimeter. Then that may not work. So these are the three points I want to say. Then for the five principles of for a code of conduct, well, let me give you just three. Number one, the South China Sea is a common good. Historically, the South China Sea, since many centuries, was a sea of exchange. It was not kind of under the sovereignty of a single state. At the time, there was no sovereignty in kind of the concept of sovereignty. It didn't exist in Eastern, Southeast Asia in any event. And even, you know, the South China Sea was a sea of exchange even before the concept of sovereignty existed anywhere in the world. And I believe the South China Sea today is still the sea of exchange. And if we take that idea serious, then maybe the idea of, you know, regulating everything on a, okay, or submitting the South China Sea to national jurisdictions may not be the only idea how to regulate a kind of South China Sea. So I would say, number one, South China Sea is a common good. Number two, all adjacent peoples should be allowed to benefit the maximum from the resources of the South China Sea. By resources, I mean not only fishery, hydrocarbon resources, but also from the exchange that sea makes possible. And number three, the use of the South China Sea should be limited with a view to the benefit of future generations.
Thank you. The time is very constrained. I will take, so a lot of people are going to raise questions. But I think I'll take one more question. Yes, there.
Congratulations, you make a very thoughtful proposal. And just built on your proposal, I would like to have two questions. First one is that what it make difference if ASEAN going to be a member of UNCLOS at an organization. And second, we always heard that the South China Sea dispute is so complicated, so we should leave it for the future generation to settle it. So what kind of expectation for the generation that you believe that have the capacity to settle the South China Sea dispute?
I'm sorry, but can you elaborate more on the first question, the first one?
What make it different if ASEAN is a member of UNCLOS at an organization, as according to your proposal?
Why? Thank you.
I will answer the questions as a legal researcher, and I would like to say that after the final awards of the South China Sea dispute case between the Philippines and China, the dispute in South China Sea is not complicated anymore. That's its dispute in South China Sea can categorize into four subjects. The four category. The first category concerning the sovereignty over rocks. Now it's not important anymore. Because rock cannot generate the ESS or continental shelf, it just have 12 nautical miles. If every state in the South China Sea agree to keep the status quo, there's no problem with who claims sovereignty over the maritime feature. The second dispute concerning maritime delimitations. And now, after the award, also after the awards, maritime delimitation in the south of South China Sea between Vietnam, Malaysia, Brunei, and the Philippines is not the case. For example, in our proposal, you can see that we propose that the Vietnam, Malaysia, and the Philippines should jointly submit the limits of their continental shelf to the CLCS to consider, because right now, those features in the South China Sea cannot, so there's no overlapping of the continental shelf generated from the mainland of those states and the maritime feature. So it's much less complicated. And the third category of this dispute concerning environment. And for environment, everybody know that we should, it's like something public good, we just mentioned, and it's the key for every disputed state in the South China Sea develop trust building capacity. We choose the trust building capacity on the environment and environment issues. And the last issue concerning natural resources, we have fishery, oils, and gas. Fishery, according to Professor Robert Beckman, no question asked, there's no fish anymore in the next few years, or there's no disputed concerning dispute anymore. And for oil and gas, I had to repeat it again. If they choose the choice submission to the CFCS of those countries, we can cooperate to explore gas and oil in the continental shelf of the South China Sea. So I would like to say it's not complicated anymore, and it's very easy for the young generation like us to settle it and develop it to make South China Sea great again.
Thank you very much. I think the point raised by the young leaders are so attractive and very courageous. There are lots of things that our conference has to think about and work out how we are going to help them. Firstly, the network of the young leaders we had to set up. Secondly, the contact point is important because you rarely meet each other. Every year we had one conference and you come and you discuss for a certain minutes or hours. It's not enough for you to come to any feasible recommendation. Thirdly, you need the funding. The young leader also need the funding, mostly from the research institutes who take part in this conference. It is also the headache for you to think about, but I think that for the younger generation to work, because the future is theirs, not ours, we can help, we can assist, but they need to work for themselves in the future. That's why I call all the research institute to help in any way you possibly can to help for the young network, young leader network, so that they could have the conference, they could have us in recommending more and more suggestion and project and program which could help to turn South China Sea a sea of peace and cooperation. Before ending, I would like to ask you to join me in giving a big applause to our young leader on the table of chairman and also the young leader in the conference. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, after the young leaders session, we come to the very final end of the conference we have. But before that, there's a special session now, because that's very important that we need to gather all the ideas and proposals and anything that we haven't, the conference will be left over. So we'll introduce Her Excellency Le Gong Phung. Will chair the free discussion session. So it will be time for all of us to raise questions, ideas, and any proposal you have. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I need a secretary because they have to help me to point out who is going to talk. I thought I accomplished my duty as to chair the special section. There's another special section. I invite you to raise the question to discuss, or not question, to discuss, because if you raise this question, nobody is going to answer. You raise comment or discuss on any kind of subject of a conference, even the logistic accommodation, the timing, the place of conference, anything that you wished to contribute to the conference so that we can do the next one much, much better. Now the floor is open. anything that you could contribute to the conference? You?
This is Stein Tønnesson. I was just listening to the young leaders, and I look up and I see that your foundation is a foundation for East Sea Studies. And the young leaders, they suggested to have a regional institute. Of course, then you immediately think about where should that regional institute be, and the most obvious location would be in the middle of the sea, somewhere. And perhaps some kind of logo could be created around the sea between us, where the us is regional, and where the sea is in the middle. Because for the Chinese, it's the South Sea. For the Vietnamese, it's the East Sea. For the Philippines, it's the West Sea. For Malaysia, it's the North Sea. So it becomes between us. And this has to do with the emotions that the sea and the sea disputes raise. I would actually be curious as to the feelings of the young leaders, the emotions that they have concerning the South China Sea and its disputes. Does it cause hope, anger, disappointment, or what? And of course, a background for my question about the emotions has to do with the role of nationalism. Because in every country around the South China Sea, you learn from the media and from the schools and from the museums your national perspective. You have actually a full study of how this is done in China in the book Never Forget National Humiliation by Wang Cheng, which tells how you at school, everyone in China learns to measure the distance between China's northernmost point and the southernmost point, and the southernmost point is James Shoal. This creates a we feeling among all Chinese around the idea of the South China Sea as belonging to us. If through Twitter and all other kinds of social media, it would be possible for a regional group of young people to advance the idea of the South China Sea belonging to all of us around it, without setting a name on the region, without using national names, but just having around it, and then associate this with a craving for peace and environmental protection and taking care of the fish and other creatures for the future. That would give a kind of identification point. So I suppose this is my suggestion to the young leaders.
Thank you very much. Now, who is going to, in your opinion, comment? Yeah. Yes, please make your comment in brief way.
Thank you. Stein is a good friend of mine, but I have a little bit different opinion. When we are talking about the rule of law, when we are talking about the obligation to abide by the decision made by the international organization, made under UNCLOS, there's a rule. So what's the rule for the naming the sea? For example, the South China Sea. If that's the case, we have to look at the International Hydrographic Organization. They make the decision, they have the documents, they are using that kind of name. But in order for all people in this region to share, according to your concept, ideas, maybe we can have a nickname. Because you are right, if the Philippines asking for rule of law by using West Philippine Sea, perhaps Taiwan can say South China Sea, South Taiwan Sea. So that's what I'm saying, that usually in terms of international practice, state practice, when you have the sovereignty disputes, Tokto and Takeshima, you put it together. Is that right? So that's what I'm saying, that good idea, but that's my opinion in response to Professor Tonozon's.
Just to be precise, I do not suggest a new official name. I'm just suggesting the sea between us as a concept for a young movement.
That's why I say nickname.
Yeah.
Any other comment? Yes, please.
I think the two speakers before me have made some interesting comments. I agree with you, Professor Stein, that there is a need for sort of greater participation and a sort of participatory approach to solve the South China Sea problem. My comment to this would be that, you know, we have these conferences in which all of us get together and we repeat our national positions on the South China Sea, the, you know, security maneuvers, other actions that we all take. But there is hardly any discussion on how we can take joint ownership of the region. And I think perhaps one good way to do so would be that in one session we can have two different scholars from two different countries do a joint paper and present that joint paper and come up with some suggestions on making progress in certain areas. So rather than repeating your, I know it sounds pretty radical, and there will be very little appetite for this kind of suggestion. But better than doing this, repeating these performances every year, in which very little seems to change, perhaps it is a good idea to do so collectively. So have a team of three scholars, or maybe two scholars, work on a paper. It can be fisheries development or oil and gas or whatever, and come up with suggestions that all the three scholars think will find some acceptance within their countries, within their national polities. That could be an interesting way to look at this, because I think that at the end of the day, we are none of the wiser because we've simply said what we already knew at the back of our minds, and the youngsters were trying to bring in some new suggestions, but maybe we are already close to those suggestions. This might be a good way to sort of get over this problem.
Thank you. Anyone? Yes. Three.
Sorry, I'll do it first. My suggestion is still going back to the young leaders that we have, and we just had them presented some solution to us. Perhaps rather than using them to look at what has been discussed in the last 2 days, we perhaps the next conference give them an assignment, a topic in which they look at it, and they came up and do a presentation as panel members together with us, and probably coming up with some radical ideas in which we, the old guard, won't think of, rather than setting them at the back 2 weeks, 2 days, and then listen to us, and then come to us with a solution. If they can have a period of time in preparing it, then probably we will listen to some better good ideas. That's my take on it.
Thank you. Is anyone? Yes, please.
Well, I think I'm speaking for all of us. We are very sympathetic to that proposal, because then we don't need to do our presentation over breakfast, and then we'll come with a much nicer and well-prepared presentation rather than some patchwork.
Thank you. Yes.
Thanks, Per Erik from the Embassy of Sweden in Hanoi. This was my first time participating in this, and I think there are some great concrete proposals coming at this very end. Of course, for some of us listening to all the description, it has been great. It is extremely interesting. In the very end comes from some of the younger people in the crowd some policy recommendations. And that is perhaps what I've been sitting here thinking about throughout these 2 days. Even though I hear very clearly what my Indian colleague says, we have to avoid this being a negotiation room or a room where we basically just say our positions. But with this interesting crowd of young academics,
very experienced academics, some international guests, and also very interesting hosts. I mean, like the Diplomatic Academy, and also international guests and a number of diplomats. Maybe it's asking too much, but it would be very interesting to hear perhaps the Diplomatic Academy coming with some recommendations on what should different actors do. We've been talking about the neighbors, but you could also think about the whole international community, and you could think about not only the two biggest powers that many people have talked about during these 2 days. I heard some of the young leaders mentioning the place where I come from, the European Union, not to say that the EU should come and say or to tell what to do, but perhaps share some experiences. But we have other regions in the world as well, Latin America, Africa. Are there some other interesting policy recommendations rather than comparing notes? Who does what? What do we do next? So perhaps for the next conference, that could be a panel or at least a very clear session.
Thank you. Ivan?
So I just would like, I would like to remind to the young leaders that Deng Xiaoping at the end of the 1917, 40 years ago, said the territorial dispute in East China Sea and also in South China Sea will be solved by the next generation. 40 years later, you can see the situation and the evolution of these last 3 years. So it's better to abandon the idea to solve the dispute, because I don't see China, I don't think that China will change its position and its claims in South China Sea. So what we have to do now in the current situation? When Philippines launched the arbitration process, the land reclamation works in South China Sea was just at the beginning. It seems that the project was already on the table, especially inside the PLA, and Xi Jinping adopted this land reclamation, but it's very clear that the Philippine initiatives push China to accelerate the process. So in 3 years, between the beginning of the arbitration process and the final award from 2013 to 2016, China built airstrips, lighthouses, and other infrastructures. So it was a turning point. I don't know if the final award is a turning point in the history of South China Sea, but the turning point was, according to me, more at the beginning of the 2010 decade, around 2012 or 2013. So we cannot imagine a resolution of the territorial dispute without thinking about China's policy toward this space. China wants to be the dominant power in the South China Sea, and I don't have policy recommendation because I'm just an academic, so it's not my job to be normative, but for China, South China Sea is not a legal issue. It's a political and security issue. China and many experts in China knew since a lot of years that the position of China in the legal framework, according to the international law, is very weak. So the only solutions to fight against this weakness is to make the fait accompli in South China Sea by the construction of infrastructure. So now it seems that China stopped the process because it's time, of course, to try to discuss again. And China also is just waiting for what Southeast Asian country will do now. And you can see and observe that on the Philippine side, we have a change. So we will see what will be the policy of Duterte and also the reaction of Vietnamese authorities. But relations between China and neighbors will be very important in this process. And another remark is we just talk about sea of cooperation. So we just have to mention that we are not facing of a sea of war. It's not a sea of war. Southern Sea is not a sea of war, of course. There is many unstable situation in the world, more important than Southern Sea. We have many tensions, of course, but East Asian countries and East Asia stay also a region of economic integration. We have also many cooperation, so some of them have to be improved. And of course, the territorial disputes remain obstacle to the cooperation is in Eastern Asia, but the situation is not so black, and maybe there is some hope we can have, but regarding the territorial dispute, I think it's we have a situation now. It's just to think what states can do in the current situations in this Spratly Island and around the South China Sea. Thank you.
Thank you very much for sharing with us your idea concerning the Chinese position and what other has to do. And I think that kind of opinion will be thoroughly discussed when we have the next round. And of course, each of us can take your opinion for reference in our daily research work. Who else? Lady, yes.
I'd just like to build on some of the suggestions that have been going around the room and encourage any new initiatives to be in the form of multimedia as well. We talked about social media, but we have so many papers already on the South China Sea, and for people with short attention span like me, I think I would prefer things in visual form, and I think actually that could be an innovative way to present new and refreshing ideas and thoughts.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. I tried to respond to the question by the gentleman from Hong Kong. I come from Taiwan, not from mainland China, so that's for the purpose of discussion. I disagree with you. China will change. And right now, China changed because the Filipino fishermen and Coast Guard vessel now in the water surrounding Scarborough Shoal. That's changed. And other different things, we look at the younger generation in China, mainland China, law school students. Right now, because the arbitration, because this case, the legal education for the younger generation in China, they are learning. They know that in the future, wait and see, they are going to adopt this kind of legal approach to settle the maritime disputes. Now, there are other changes. For example, we might see the agreement between China and Vietnam regarding the mouths of Tonkin Gulf. 2000, they have the fisheries agreement. So it's possible to have that kind of agreement between Vietnam and China regarding that kind of cooperation. And then there are other possibilities, that is code of conduct, declaration, one veil, one road. So there are important things, changes within the region. So maybe we don't have to say that they don't change at all. The position is changing. And then we have to take note the treaty obligation, the UNCLOS, because China did ratify the UNCLOS in June 1996. Thank you.
Can I just give my view on the Gulf of Tonkin? I think the Gulf of Tonkin, it's an exception. And I'm not sure that this maritime delimitation can be an example for the rest of the South China Sea. Why? The Gulf of Tonkin, it's a very specific geographical area. It's a gulf, epicontinental part of the South China Sea. There is no territorial dispute, no strategic stake. Okay? And the delimitation of the Gulf of Tonkin was very specific because it's the continuation of the land border agreement of 1999. The Sino-French Convention of the 1860 delimited the Vietnamese, the border between China and French Indochina, okay? But also share some islands in the Gulf of Tonkin. So two countries just renegotiate the agreement of 1860. It was necessary to discuss about the Gulf of Tonkin. And regarding the fishery agreement, China made the proposal to Vietnam to establish also the junk fishing zone. And at the beginning, the Vietnamese part was not so motivated for discussing about fishery, but it was a very important stake for China at the domestic level. So they made some success in the delimitation, but I'm not sure that it will be possible to shift this model to the west of South China Sea. And regarding the discussion about the morph of Gulf of Tonkin, yes, they began to discuss about that, but I'm not sure there is a very good advance and evolution on this point. But I can make mistake, but it's my view.
Yeah, interesting. You?
If you say that the Tonkin Gulf Agreement is just an exception, in a way you build up the idea that it is not possible to resolve the rest of the dispute. But it won't be resolved in one big jump or in one package. The Tonkin Gulf Agreement was also difficult. It was much easier than much of the rest, but it was very difficult. There were principal differences between the Vietnamese and the Chinese position from the beginning. And the next step might not be very, very long, but it could be simply to succeed with the ongoing negotiations about prolonging the boundary from the mouth of the Gulf of Tonkin, a little bit down in the direction of the first dash in the U-shaped line, and in the direction of the parasols, with a possible implication for that, that could then have a positive effect on the rest. And it's not a question of having a model to be applied for the rest, because I agree with you there, but it's a question of having some progress. And there are other parts of the South China Sea where it could also be possible to make some progress by making some kind of agreement. We've talked about the possible fishery agreements. And there are also boundary disputes like between Indonesia and Vietnam with the question of the single line and so on that could be resolved. Each time you do something, you start approaching the end solution so that it's possible to keep up a momentum. I agree. Fully agree with you, Yan Wei, that China is going to change. I'm not sure. But I agree with you anyway, because I can see that there is no possibility of a resolution of the maritime disputes in the South China Sea unless China changes its mindset. And I'm also quite convinced that this is in China's long-term interest, because it needs peace in its neighborhood when it's growing in order to avoid rivalry and conflict with the United States.
Thank you for the very good question and answer and discussion among ourselves in the last minutes of the meeting. I think now is time up. I would like to invite the director of DAV to make his conclusion of the meeting. Mr. Tung.
Hello again. First of all, let me on behalf of the organizers to share with you some thoughts, concluding thoughts on the 2 days seminar conference. I think that with the 7 sections and 1 special section with the young leaders, we have successfully accomplished the goals we set for the conference 2 days ago. We have so many thought-provoking presentations, and these presentations were joined by the active questions and comments from the audience. According to the statistics, I'm not so sure about that. We have about 150 times people participating with questions and comments, and we just witnessed the last round of discussions just a few seconds ago. And all this shows that we have been successful in the process of knowledge sharing, and we came out of the conference, I believe, intellectually richer and socially richer too. I'm not intending to sum up or the present something like consensus views on the 2 days conference, because it is next to impossible. But I would like to highlight some points, and I hope that you might agree with me. One, the historical research is in greater demand. We have been so lucky to have at least four presentations in the first panel, which I chaired, about the historical findings in the South China Sea. And I think that this is fascinating, and the historical research needs to be done more. And I personally think that we would have some papers on the history of the South China Sea dispute in the next conference. The second point is about the PCA rulings. I think we can agree that this is the PCA award in July is the landmark, is the watershed in all of the years that we have been talking about the South China Sea. Just imagine, this year, for example, this conference, we are still talking about 9-9 in the hectic or in the heated manner like it was a few years back. We can agree that, however, the PCA award is not the panacea, because it can not heal everything, at least from the fact that China is not accepting it. There is no enforcement mechanism to ask for the parties concerned to abide by it, and we still have different interpretations about the international, the UNCLOS in general and the PCA award in specific. We also discussed about the new changes in the domestic politics, in the party directly or indirectly concerned. I would like to name the Philippines, Malaysia, Indonesia, and the US. And together with the other factors, such as the oil price changes, the fluctuation, and then the fishery demand, and even the OBOR, and especially the geostrategic considerations by countries such as the United States in the with the new administration, and then India, Japan, we seem to have a higher level of uncertainty in at least in the next year and on. The PCA also promised about the legal and diplomatic processes, and actually they are taking place and with some implications for us to further study. And of course, we don't fail to mention the facts in the ground, that we in the aspect that the countries concerned are doing actual activities on the ground. I also see that we spend time talking about cooperation. And the range of cooperative activities can start with the efforts to avoid incidents at sea or to reduce the misunderstanding or the failure of communication. The case of queues have been cited, and I think that we seem to have a good case here in terms of avoiding such undesirable activities.
the exploitation of resources, especially fish, is also mentioned, along with the efforts to promote cooperation to cope with non-traditional security threats. I personally think that we should have had some more time discussing about what ASEAN can do, at least in the sense that ASEAN can maintain the central role in managing the dispute, stabilizing the situation, as well as forging the new type of consensus when ASEAN countries are addressing the this South China Sea issue. And it, at the bottom line, and I think that we have talked about it, but I personally think that we should do more about the political will and about the trust that are basically serving as the foundation for cooperation. And I agree with the points raised by the Swiss ambassador about the policy recommendation, but we know what we are talking about, and it is our role as the track two people to inform and to influence our own government before we can come up with some collective policy suggestions. So with that, I would like to thank all of you, the presenters, the commentators, and the audience, to help the organizers to have such a successful conference. And last but not least, I'd like to extend special thanks to the staff, the DAV staff, the Intercon staff, and the press, and especially the two interpreters who are working very hard in the booth right now to help us to make sure that our conference is a successful one. I'm not saying goodbye, because we still have some other activities that includes the farewell dinner tonight, and then the trip to the Nyachang Kam Reng Port tomorrow. So I would like to invite the organizers to give the housekeeping announcement. Thank you very much again.
Thank you, Mr. Dong. And I'm just very brief, and I know you're on time, so just be present at 6:30 at the lobby of the conference room, so that we go to the farewell dinner together. And tomorrow, 8:30 at also the lobby, so we will pick you up to the Cam Ranh port. And please bring your passport. And in case, of course, I hope that all the people who have dropped off the airport will talk to our secretariat. And I'll see you tonight. Yep.